Hello, my name is Yunjeong Park. I'm an undergraduate student at Bio and Brain Engineering Department. In this video lecture, I'll present the rest part of the Chapter 10, Growth Factors and Wound Healing. The contents of the second part of this chapter is presented as here. Six types of growth factors and their wound healing principles will be discussed. The wound healing process is complex and not yet fully understood. The various cells are involved in such process and secrete various growth factors, which are called mitogens. The growth factors that appear most significant to this process include FGFs, TGFs, PDGFs, IGF, and EGF. These mitogens stimulate the growth and activation of various cell types, including fibroblasts, epithelial cells, and vascular endothelial cells. Such cells advance healing by promoting processes such as granulation and subsequent epithelialization. Granulation refers to the growth of the connective tissue and small blood vessels at the healing surface. Wounds can be categorized as acute or chronic. Acute wound heals quickly on their own. The fluid exuded from a fresh or acute wound generally exhibits high levels of various growth factors, which promote the fast wound healing process. Unlike acute wounds, chronic wounds heal slowly and often require medication. It occurs if some influence disrupts the normal healing process, such as diabetes, malnutrition, rheumatoid arthritis, and ischemia. Elderly people are particularly susceptible to developing chronic wounds. In contrast to the fluid exuded from the acute wound, the fluid from the chronic wound has much lower concentration of the mitogens. Thus, direct application of the exogenous growth factors can result in accelerated wound healing in animals. Furthermore, the chronic wound harbors high levels of proteolytic activity, almost 200-fold higher than the acute wound. Resulting proteolytic degradation fails the mitogen-stimulated wound healing process. So, the identification of suitable protease inhibitors are required for the application in conjunction with the exogenous mitogen therapy. The example of chronic wound is ulcer. I'll explain various types of ulcers and their causes in the next slide. There are five types of ulcers described by the author of the textbook: decubitus, diabetic, varicose, rodent, and peptic ulcers. Decubitus ulcer, also known as pressure ulcer, is the ulcer due to continuous pressure exerted on a particular area of skin. It is often associated with bedridden patients, so it develops more common over bony prominences such as heels, lower part of one's back, and the bottom. Diabetic ulcers are caused by complications of diabetes. Commonly called as diabetic foot ulcer, it occurs in 15% of all patients with diabetes and precedes 84% of all lower leg amputations. The failure in wound healing process, as well as development of macro and microvascular complications, lead to diabetic ulcers in many diabetic patients because diabetes itself is one such metabolic disorder that impedes the normal steps of the wound healing process. Next is varicose ulcers, which are wounds that are thought to occur due to defective circulation in varicose veins, usually of the medial distal legs. They are the major occurrence of chronic wounds, occurring in 70 to 90% of leg ulcer cases. Next is rodent ulcer. It is an ulcerous cancer that usually affects the face, so that it is often called as basal cell carcinoma. It is the most common cancer. It rarely metastasizes or kills, but it can cause significant destruction and disfigurement by invading surrounding tissues, so it is considered malignant. Lastly, I'll explain about the peptic ulcer, the ulcer of the digestive tract, caused by digestion of the mucosa by acid and pepsin. It may occur in the duodenum or the stomach. When it occurs in the duodenum, it is called duodenal ulcer, and the one occurs in the stomach is called gastric ulcer. Generally, four times as many peptic ulcers arise in the duodenum as in the stomach itself. Now, I'll explain various growth factors and their wound healing principles. First one that will be described is insulin-like growth factors. As the name suggests, these growth factors bear a strong structural resemblance to insulin, pro-insulin more accurately. The major site of the IGF synthesis is the liver. The IGFs synthesized in the liver act as endocrine manner, while IGFs from numerous sites in the body act as autocrine or paracrine manner. IGFs exhibit a wide range of gross physiological effects. Please refer to Table 10.10 of the textbook for more details about IGF's effects. IGFs play a major stimulatory role in promoting the cell cycle and contribute to sustaining the uncontrolled cell growth characteristic of cancer cells. Therefore, virtually all mammalian cell types display surface IGF receptors. During adulthood, IGFs also play a core role in tissue renewal and repair, which is the wound healing process. For example, these mitogens play a central role in bone remodeling. So, when proper amount of IGF is not present, they can influence the development of osteoporosis. Let us get into the detail about the IGFs. The IGFs constitute a family of two closely related polypeptides, IGF-1 and IGF-2. Most of the growth-promoting effects of growth hormones are actually mediated by IGF-1. Direct injection of IGF-1 into animals whose pituitary is surgically removed stimulates longitudinal bone growth as well as growth of several organs and glands. Such effects render IGFs likely therapeutic candidates in treating the various forms of dwarfism caused by a dysfunction of growth hormone. IGF-1 regulates renal functions as well. The injection of IGF-1 promotes increase in glomerular filtration rate, renal plasma flow, and kidney size and weight. So it is considered as a potential therapeutic agent in the treatment of various forms of kidney disease in future days. IGF-2 is produced mainly by tissue and vascular interfaces with the brain. Both IGF-1 and 2, along with insulin, play a number of important roles in the nervous system. They stimulate the growth and development of various neuronal populations and promote neurotrophic effects. Therefore, they may be of potential use in the treatment of various neurodegenerative diseases. Epidermal growth factor is a 6 kilodalton, 53 amino acid, unglycosylated peptide. It was one of the first growth factors discovered. It has proven to exert a powerful mitogenic effect on many cell types, particularly on endothelial cells, epithelial cells, and fibroblasts. So the skin and the wounds in the epidermal layer appear to be EGF's major physiological target. Platelet-derived growth factor was first identified 20 years ago as being the major growth factor synthesized by platelets. PDGF plays an important role in the wound healing process. It is released at the site of damage by activated platelets and acts as a mitogen or chemoattractant for many of the cells responsible for initiation of tissue repair. So, it tends to act primarily in a paracrine manner. It exhibits a mitogenic effect on fibroblasts, smooth muscle cells, and glial cells. Active PDGF is a dimer. There are two constituent polypeptides, A and B, and there are three active PDGF isoforms, AA, AB, and BB. Of these three, in vitro studies suggest that PDGF AB or BB dimeric isoforms are the most potent in wound healing. It has been proven that PDGF is of value in wound management, particularly with regard to chronic wounds. Both human trials with PDGF BB isoform showed higher healing rates of chronic wounds. Daily topical application of PDGF stimulated remarkable acceleration in healing rates of decubitus and diabetic ulcers. But only the application of the PDGF on chronic diabetic ulcer is shown to be statistically significant. Next growth factor is fibroblast growth factors. FGFs constitute a family of about 20 proteins, which are numbered consecutively from FGF1 to FGF20. Typically, they display a molecular mass in the region of 18 to 28 kilodalton and induce a range of mitogenic, chemotactic, and angiogenic responses. All display a 140 amino acid central core that is highly homologous between all family members. All FGFs also tightly bind heparin and heparin-like glycosaminoglycans found in the extracellular matrix. This property has been used to purify several such FGFs via heparin affinity chromatography. Although many of the original members of this family stimulate the growth or development of fibroblasts, as the name suggests, several newer members have little or no effect upon fibroblasts. Keratinocyte growth factor, the FGF7, is thus far the only member of the FGF family to have gained approval for general medical use. TGFs are another family of polypeptide mitogens. This family includes TGF-alpha and TGF-beta. TGF-alpha is initially synthesized as an integral membrane protein. Proteolytic cleavage releases the soluble growth factor, which exhibits a high amino acid homology with EGF. Therefore, it induces its biological effects by binding to the EGF receptor. It is synthesized by various body tissues as well as tumor cell types, for which it can act as an autocrine growth factor. TGF-beta consists of three separate growth factors, TGF-beta 1, 2, and 3. These are the product of distinctive genes, but they all exhibit close homology. In the mature form, they exist as homodimers. Most body cells synthesize TGF-beta singly or in combination. When it was first described, it was thought to be capable of inducing transformation of several fibroblast cell lines. Nowadays, TGF-betas are known to be pleiotropic cytokines. They are capable of inhibiting cell cycle and cell growth of several cell types such as epithelial and hematopoietic cells. These induce the synthesis of extracellular matrix proteins and modulate the expression of matrix proteases. TGF-betas also serve as a powerful chemoattractant for monocytes and fibroblasts. With these properties, it can be concluded that TGF-betas are related to tissue remodeling, wound repair, and hemopoiesis. The last growth factor is neurotropic factors. Neurotropic factors constitute a group of cytokines that regulate the development, maintenance, and survival of neurons, both in the central and peripheral nervous system. The major subfamily of neurotropic factors is a neurotrophins. Unlike conventional understanding, many neurotrophic factors are synthesized not only by the neuronal target cells, but also by the non-nerve target cells and influence cells other than neurons. For example, NGF is synthesized by mast cells and influences various cells in the immune system. Furthermore, including several growth factors discussed previously, various cytokines are now also known to influence neuronal cells. Many NGFs sustain specific neuronal populations whose death underlines various neurodegenerative diseases. This raises the possibility that these regulatory molecules may provide future effective treatments for some currently incurable neurodegenerative conditions. So far, we have discussed about six types of growth factors and their applications in wound areas. In conclusion, a range of growth factors may demonstrate potential in wound management or healing or for other therapeutic indication. Carefully studying these and more growth factors may lead to a better and effective wound treatment in future days. This is the end of my video presentation, and thank you.